So we're continuing our series called Those Are Not My People. And I really missed you all last week. We got snowed out, so I was sitting at home trying to find somebody on TV to watch a good sermon or on the internet. And I just couldn't find anybody good enough, so I had to go back and watch myself preach. Just kidding. You guys think like I'm like that anyway, so I just had to say something silly. But Mr. Vera, I loved watching you dancing up here, man. You inspired me today. That was awesome. Put on some Spanish music and you watch him. He was going at it. All right. So have you ever walked into a room, a situation, church, whatever, and immediately you look around and you're like, these are not my people. These are not my people. I'll be honest with you. I walked into a room of pastors not that long ago, and the second I walked in, I scanned the room, and I'm like, these are not my people. Not at all. They're not my people. And if pastors were not my people, then, like, who are my people? I went to Colorado for a conference, and I walked into the church, and it didn't really dawn on me at first. I'm just like, something's wrong here. Something's wrong with this church. And so I'm thinking to myself, okay, you know, is something wrong with the pastor? Is something wrong with the worship? Like, what is wrong with this church? And then as I looked around, it dawned on me, there was only white people in the room. And I felt out of place. Like, these are not my people. These are not my people. I felt weird in that environment. That's not me. And so something happens to the inside of us when we have this sense of, these are not my people. And it's this idea that hits us that says, I don't belong here. I don't belong here. And this idea of belonging is deeper than you can even imagine. We have to feel like we belong with a people, with a tribe, with a group. As a pastor, it's very important that you find a group of other pastors that you fit in with. And those are the guys that you have in as your guest speakers, and you establish friendships with them. And I think the same thing is in our own personal lives. We have groups of friends, or, you know, maybe when we were younger, we called them cliques. But we knew we belonged with those people. This idea of me belonging even shifts into this, I don't fit in here. I don't fit in. I don't belong. But maybe you're on the other side. Maybe you've experienced it when someone new comes into your clique or to your church or to your job, and you say, they don't belong here. Something's wrong with them. They're weird or whatever. They don't belong with us. And this sense of belonging is one that is absolutely one of the most important feelings that we're ever going to have, believe it or not. It's a very, very important feeling. Belonging helps us understand what love is, and belonging helps us understand what it means to change and to be changed. In fact, some people stay way too long in an unhealthy environment or an unhealthy relationship just because they feel like they belong there. They can't tell you any other reason why. They don't like the person. They don't love the person. They don't like the environment. But I don't know. I feel like this is where I belong. And so we've noticed that there was a trend in church, not so much this church, but church at large. Church had this idea that said, you must behave yourself, believe what we believe, and then you can belong here. Right? And so a lot of people over the years said, you know, I can't go to that church because I don't belong there. I don't fit in. We've heard people say, oh my God, if I walked into a church, the roof would cave in. Because those are not my people. That's church people, and I'm something else. And so here at Family Church, we want to take that idea and flip it upside down. I want to say that no matter who you are, what walk of life you come from, you belong here. You belong here. The more you attend Family Church, you will begin to see why we believe You belong. You'll begin to see why we believe what we believe, and you'll begin to believe some of the things that we believe. As you believe those things and the Word of God penetrates your heart, you'll begin to behave in a way that aligns with the Word of God. It's not that we're trying to change people's behavior. We're trying to change people's lives. We're trying to change people's eternal destination. Behavior just kind of happens when we begin to believe the same things, right? So to belong or to fit in, to be accepted, is at the core of who we are. Yet we have this tension in society today. And listen to me very carefully. I'm not going to get into anything too deep, but we have this tension in society today of being uneasy about where we belong. If I started talking about politics today, which we are not, I could split the church. I could split the church. If I started talking about politics, half the people in the room would get walk out. If I started blasting any views, whatever those views might be, we could easily split the church. And it's not even really about a political party or a personality. It's much, much bigger than that. It's a divide in our culture and a divide in our country that is growing deeper and deeper every day. You want to see how fast you are actually divided from people in your life? Do you really want to test it out? I don't know if you do. But it's called the Facebook test. I'm just going to give it to you. Here's the litmus test. Find a hot topic on the internet. And for today's example, we're going to use the idea of spanking your children. Right? Spanking your children is definitely a hot topic today. So to spank or not to spank, that is the question. If you were spanked by your parents, you're probably a non-spanker. And if you were not spanked by your parents, you're probably a not spanker. If you're just an angry person, you're probably a spanker. I don't know. I just made that up. Here's the Facebook test. Go and find an article that is, you know, pro-spanking. That says, man, if your kid looks at you the wrong way, spank them. Right? I'm just making fun here. And don't write an editorial. Don't write anything but amen. That's it. Just type amen and post it. Watch how fast you have a Facebook crisis on your hands. Watch how fast people unfriend you, unfollow you, block you, put hate mail in your direct messaging just for saying amen. Why? Because we're so divided. We're so divided of opinion. As if our opinion is fact. And as if someone else is not allowed to have an opinion. We're divided on hot topics. You name it. Whatever it is, we are divided. Facebook started a fight about whether a dress was blue or white years ago. Right? It's still out there somewhere, right? This divide is deepening and causing huge amounts of tension. So here's my big idea today. This is why I wrote this whole series with this question. How do we relate to others who are significantly different from us? How do we relate to others who are significantly different than us? How do we get along with other people that we disagree with? How do we disagree without fighting? We've heard the old statement, well, we just agreed to disagree. But no one's mature enough to do that anymore. We live in a country that has freedom of speech, but you only have freedom of speech if you say something people want to hear. The moment you say something no one wants to hear, whatever. And this idea weighs heavy on me, and it weighs heavy on you too. Why? Because God designed us to live in harmony with other people. God designed us to live in harmony with animals. There was no predatory animals when God first created the earth. It wasn't that way. Adam wasn't afraid of the lions and the tigers and the bears. He wasn't. We desire in and of ourselves to be known and to know other people, to connect with other people. And this is the way that God designed it. All the way up until Genesis 2:18, all the way up until that moment, everything God created was good. The plants were good. The ocean was good. The trees were good. The animals were good. And then Genesis 2:18 comes along and he says, "It is not good that man be alone." God created us to live in something called community. Community, and I know community is kind of a buzzword today, especially if you're into leadership stuff and corporate America information. We're created to live in community, to belong with others. And when this isn't happening, all kinds of things begin to happen on the inside of us and around us. Here's the issue. Although every single one of us desires to be known and to know others, and to live in community, and to live in harmony, almost all of our relationships are superficial. Superficial. "Hey, bro, how you doing?" "I'm good." "You good?" "Yeah, I'm good." "How's the kids?" "They're good." "How's your kids?" "Good." How's the wife?" "Good." "Your wife?" "Good." "How's the job?" "Good." "I'm good." "How's the weather?" "It was good." "Hey, bro, you see the Super Bowl?" "That was crazy." "Yeah, it was crazy, right? Did you have money on the Falcons?" "Yeah, money. I lost $10. And that's it. Like, we got nothing. And I'm dying inside. And you're dying inside. And I don't know what to do for my job tomorrow. And but we're going to talk about the weather. It's crazy outside. It's so warm. What happened last week? We got snowed out. Who cares? Who are you? What have you been created to do, and how can I help you get there? Well, I really wasn't thinking we were going to get that deep today. Give me a few days to process that. But this is exactly what we want. We want somebody to recognize us. You want somebody to remember and recognize you when you walk into church. You want that. No, 80% of you would die if we asked you to come up on stage right now. 80% of the people in here are introverts, and they're just like, "Oh my God." You'd start shaking and break out in a cold sweat if I said, "Hey, come up on here and stage with me real quick." Alex, he's a different kind of person. He would take the mic and just talk to you on stage here today. Yet you want someone to recognize you. You want someone to know that you're here. That's why we do come to church, part of it. It's like an act of service. I just want them to know that I did my job. I showed up to church today. I did what I was supposed to do, right? Because we do want to be connected to something that's bigger than us. We want to be connected to something that's making a difference. And we want to be part of making a difference in the world today, yet we don't know how to break down the wall of this insecurity or pride or whatever it is to be vulnerable enough to actually address some of the things that are happening on the inside of us. So although we're looking for relationship, those relationships happen to be somewhat superficial. Our lives are full of relationships, but very few connections. And as a church, we want this to be a place where you feel you belong the moment you walk through the doors. We want you to connect not just to other believers, but to a holy God. That's why we take a half hour and turn the lights down, because we're insecure and we don't want to see each other raise our hands. We turn the lights down so that we can connect to a holy God in a way that's uncomfortable for us. Because we're here on this earth for something more than just to have fun. So begin to look at the design that God made for the church today. And in John 13:35, he says this: "By this, everyone will know that you attend family church right? By this, everyone will know that you are a Christian. You are a Christ follower. That you have gone from death to life, that Jesus Christ has become your Lord and Savior. By this, people will know if you love one another. If you choose to love one another. Man, it is so easy to not show love to people. It's so easy to show anger to people. Because many times we're more full of anger than we are full of love. And so this began to challenge my thinking, my mentality. By this, everyone will know that this is the church where there is love for one another. Wouldn't it be great that if people began to say that they knew they were home when they walked through the doors of a church because they felt loved? I really wouldn't want people saying, man, I want to go to that family church because they got cool lights and sound. Then we didn't do the job in the parking lot and at the front door. Because in the front door, they should experience love that was greater than lights and sound. Right? Today, we're going to look at an interaction that Jesus had with a Jewish expert of the law. And it starts out like a really good joke. You got this priest, you got a Levite, and you got a Samaritan. Right? And they're all going down the street. And in Luke 10:25, it says this. On one occasion, an expert of the law, a Jewish man, an expert of the Jewish law, which is the first five books of your Bible. This guy not only was an expert at the first five books of the Bible, he has memorized the first five books of the Bible and at any point can recite it back to you. The entire thing. Not just like a few scriptures. Like, do you know how much words there are? That's a lot. He's devoted himself. On one occasion, an expert of the law stood up to test Jesus. Now, I know that some of us think that Jesus was kind of a pushover because he allowed guys to beat him up and hang him on a cross and kill him. But he was not a pushover. He said, listen, the only reason why you're beating my tail right now is because I'm allowing you to. And no one can take my life. I choose to lay it down. So when you step to test Jesus, you're about to get served. You're about to get served. And you got to understand this. If there's a Jewish expert of the law who's standing up to test Jesus, they're in a room of other Jewish experts of the law. So this is about to be a showdown between the one who professes himself the king of the Jews and an expert of the Jews. He stands up to test Jesus. Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Now, here's the next thing you have to understand about Jesus. Not only was he highly intellectual, he also had the Holy Spirit without measure. So the moment a question is asked of him, he already knows the intention by which the question is asked. That's like, you ever start texting somebody and all of a sudden they start using capital letters? You know, that's the time that you got to stop texting and get them on the phone, right? Because what do your capital letters mean exactly? Are you getting excited or are you yelling at me? Now I want to hear the tone of your voice. I want to try to discern, do we have a problem? Or are we just getting excited about what we're texting about? Jesus knows that this guy is not asking him this question for his own personal education. He's asking this question to corner Jesus because he believes he knows more than the word himself. Whew, I got the chill bumps. That's all fine and dandy that you can quote the first five books, but I am the first five books. I am he that was alive and was dead, and I'll be alive forevermore. Hey, before it was on the pages, I am. Before you could read it, I was walking it. Hey, in fact, I'm the one who spoke it so your man Moses could write it. Test me. Test me, please. Woo! I'm going to have to go back and watch that. Dang, that was good. Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? So Jesus answers back to him, what is written in the law? How do you read it? What's he saying? You tell me. You're so smart. You memorized the first five books of the Bible. What do you think it is? So really what this guy's asking is this. What is the most important commandment of the law? What's the most important thing? If I do this one thing, I will inherit eternal life. And so Jesus says, what do you think it is? After all, you are so smart. I would have to add that. Jesus didn't. He didn't play those games. But this is a big question. This is a big question. I'll tell you why. Because we only know about 10 commandments. And I say we know about them because we don't even know them. Thou shalt have no other God before thee, God. Thou shalt not worship any graven images. There's a few there. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not covet. There's more in there. There happens to be 613 commandments. There are 613 commandments spread over five books of the Bible. And this guy's about to answer which one of the 613 is the most important. Jesus says, what do you think it is? Out of all 613, what do you believe the most important commandment is? And in Luke 10:27, this guy answers it perfectly. He answers, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind. And the second part to that would be, love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus answers back to him, you have answered correctly. If you do this, you will live. If you do this, you will have eternal life. This guy nails it. He quotes. Now, this is what we don't understand about the Bible. Sometimes we need to study it a little bit deeper. This guy is quoting two verses out of two vastly different books of the Bible. He's quoting Deuteronomy 6:5, which says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your strength, with all your might. And then he's quoting Leviticus 19:18. You're correct, Jesus says. You have summed up all 613 commandments in two verses found in two very different books of the Bible. But this guy is not satisfied because he already knew the answer. Again, this is a setup. He's setting Jesus up. Most guys are not going to ask questions they don't already know the answer to. Just learn that, ladies. It's just an ego thing. We just got to make sure that you know that we know what we're talking about. Right? And this is what he's doing here. So he's not finished. He's not happy with that. So would you make me answer my own question? Because I already knew that. It's not working out for him. He's not looking all that great. So he says, to justify himself, he goes on in Luke 10:29, but the man wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? So you must love your neighbor as yourself. He says, but who's my neighbor? That's a good question. That's a good question. He's asking, who do I need to be concerned about? Who do I need to love well? Who are my people and who are not my people? And I thought, why is this man asking this kind of question? Is he trying to get out of loving certain people? Like, why is he asking a question in this way? And so I had to go searching. I'm not understanding this. I'm not that smart. I didn't get this the first time around. I'm like, why is he asking this question? Is he just trying to look smarter and smarter than Jesus? Why is he asking this? And then I read Leviticus 19:18 in its entirety. He only quoted the last part of it. The first part says this, do not seek revenge or bear a grudge against a fellow Israelite, but love your neighbor as yourself. Now, if you're a Jewish person reading this, this kind of leans to the fact to say that the only people that I have to worry about are fellow Israelites, my own people, that I only have to love well fellow Israelites. So who are my neighbors? It's a legitimate question. So Jesus does what he does. He doesn't answer you. He tells a story. right? In Luke 10:30, this is called the story of the Good Samaritan. It's funny how our country wants to get so far away from the Bible, but we have the Samaritan Act and the Samaritan laws and the Good Samaritan law. It's quoting Bible. This is where they get the story from. This is where we get the laws from. In Luke 10:30, in reply, Jesus says, again, Jesus don't even answer this dude. So who is my neighbor? Well, you see, there was a man walking down from Jerusalem to Jericho. When he was attacked by robbers, they stripped him of his clothes, they beat him and went away, leaving him half dead. Sounds like a typical Facebook video. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by the other side. Now, just let me defend priests for 1 second. The reason why, and it's not an excuse, but to understand a priest just a little bit. If the priest were to go touch a half-dead man, he would be now ceremonially unclean. And he'd have to go through this whole ritual of cleansing himself and purifying himself so that he could be worthy to then offer sacrifices and all these things again. And he just didn't have time for that. He was on his way to a bar mitzvah. So he was like, I know you need me right now. I know you're hurting and stuff, but I ain't got time for that. The story goes on. And so to a Levite, when he came to the place, he saw the man. He passed by on the other side. And then Jesus says something that is about to rock this Jewish expert's world. But a Samaritan. But a Samaritan. We're going to come back to that in a second. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey and brought him to an inn and took care of him. The next day he took him out. He took out 2 denarii and gave it to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expenses you may have. Now here's the deal. But a Samaritan. What you don't understand is this. Jews and Samaritans hated each other. Hated each other. You see, Samaritans were the cafeteria Jews. They picked and chose from other religions and other idolatries and other things and brought them together, yet they still professed to be God's chosen people. And the Jews hated that because they were living by the law. They were fulfilling it all. And you think that you could do all those things and still be God. You're not God's chosen people. Their hatred was deep. It was very deep. I think that we could see some of those sort of hatreds in our society today, in our cultural divides. This hatred goes so deep. For me to show you a little bit how deep it is, in John 4:9, there's another story where Jesus is walking into a town and there's a woman sitting by a well. She happens to be Samaritan. And Jesus asks her for a drink of water. And she says, how can you ask me, you being a Jew, ask me, a Samaritan woman, for a drink of water? And Jesus said, well, if you knew who I was, you'd be asking me for a living water. You know, he goes on to talk about this whole thing and he tells her her past. But there's a little part of this story in these brackets here. What are those things called? Parentheses? I stink at English. And it says this, for Jews, how can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans. And in my Bible, at the end of that little parentheses, there's an A, which means you need to know more information about this translation. It's actually a very hard part of the Bible to translate. But it means something like this. How can you, being a Jewish man, ask me, a Samaritan, for something to drink? For Jews will not use the same cup as a Samaritan. We will not use the same dishware. You would not drink after me. Even if you were parched and dying of thirst, we would not share the same cup. That's how deep their hatred is. For one another is. So now this Jewish expert is standing up in front of all his friends, all his comrades, and Jesus says, but a Samaritan stopped. Now, when someone tells you a story and they say, hey, you know, there was this guy and he was walking down the street and he got robbed. You assume as being the listener of a story that that person who got robbed is your kind of people. You put that picture in your mind. You associate who you are into who the character of the story is. So when Jesus says a certain man is walking down the street, this Jewish expert assumes he's a Jewish man. He assumes he's a Jewish man. Yet the Jewish priest wouldn't touch him. The Levite wouldn't touch him. But a Samaritan. But a Samaritan. But our hated foe. But someone who is definitely not your people stops and pours oil and wine on his wounds and picks him up and puts him on his own donkey. Why would he say his own donkey? Because many times someone who's traveling would have multiple donkeys. And if I hated you, you're not sitting on my seat. Yo, Bri, that's like letting some other dude drive your bike, your ride. You know what I'm saying? In fact, that's like riding backseat on your own ride. Nobody's riding backseat on your own ride. I'd rather walk. Call me a taxi. Take my bike. You know what I'm saying? He puts him on his own donkey. He didn't put him on the slave donkey. He didn't put him on five donkeys back. He gave him the authority to be on his own donkey. He paid for his night stay and his food, and he threw in extra money in case he needs anything else. It's on me. Could you see the steam rising off this Jewish expert's head right now? He's saying to himself, there's no way a Samaritan would do that. But Jesus didn't say who the man was, what his nationality was, what his background was, what his skin color was. Whether he ate chuleta or not, he didn't say any of that. He just said a certain man, and this Jewish expert drew his own conclusion. But a Samaritan. How strong was their hate? So Jesus says this Samaritan man had mercy on the beaten man, bandaged him up, carried him on his own donkey, paid for his room and board, and he ends his story with another question. This is where Jesus is so sly. In front of all his men, in front of all his peers, in front of all these smart guys, Jesus asked this question. Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? Who do you think was a neighbor? And if you're careful, you'll miss what Jesus did here. Do you remember what the man's question was? Who is my neighbor? Who is my neighbor? And Jesus completely turns the question around and asks him, who was a neighbor? Not who is your neighbor, but who was a neighbor? Who was being neighborly? Who was being like Christ would be? Who's being like the church should be? Not who goes to church. But who's acting like they should be acting? Because that's a big difference. It's one saying, hey, who goes to church? And the next one says, who's acting like the church? It ain't the same thing. Jesus flips this around. And he makes this guy answer that question in front of all his men. He's asking him, you answer me who your people are. Who am I responsible to love? Who am I to care for? Who was a neighbor? Luke 10:37, the expert in the law replied, and I think he kind of went like this, like, the one who had mercy on him. He won't even say Samaritan. He won't even say it. He's so upset it won't even come out of his mouth. He just said, the one who had mercy on him, obviously, because now he ain't so smart. Now it's not about his intellect. Now it's not about his persona. It's about something a little bit deeper within. Jesus is pointing out, you got a screwed up heart. You got a messed up heart. Who is the one I'm supposed to take care of? The one who had mercy on him. He says, is the neighbor. And Jesus says, go and do likewise. You go and do likewise. He said, church, go and do likewise. Go and be the neighbor. Stop waiting for who's supposed to be your neighbor. And you go be a neighbor. You go be the church. You go look for the one who's down and out and hurting and in need. Go look for the one who has it all together because they need the love too. He says, go and do likewise. He's telling him someone who doesn't fit your circle, someone who doesn't belong in your story, the one type of person that's not your people. He said, that's your neighbor. That's your neighbor. Wow. The man who did not fit the story. That man should not have been in a Jewish story. He was a neighbor. How do we relate to people who are significantly different from us? And Jesus boils it down to the strongest four-letter word you'll ever hear. Love. 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 He stopped to help this man who was beaten, not because he fit his social economical level. He stopped because of love for humanity. He didn't stop to help somebody because the skin color was right, the part of the neighborhood was right, the car that they drove was right. He stopped because he had mercy for a fellow human. Human. He didn't say they had the right sexual preference. He didn't say that he smelled like perfume instead of vomit. He had mercy on someone who needed what he had. Listen, if you open your heart this morning, I'm feeling the presence of God speak to us this morning. You're carrying around something inside of you that this world is crying out for. It might not be the right vehicle to transport somebody. It might not be the 2 denarii to pay the innkeeper. But you have a peace that lives inside of you that this world is crying out for. It is by no accident that the Bible says that God is love. It doesn't say that God has love. God is love. God is love. And when you accept God into your life, you possess, you have his kind of love living on the inside of you. And that's what this world needs. That's what this world needs. It doesn't need more bad comments online. It needs love. It doesn't need more people. Now listen, don't get me wrong. I believe that us going into our rooms and praying for people is needed and it's healthy. I do. But I don't think we need more people in prayer closets. We need more people touching people's lives. We need people who are acting out Christianity in the streets, acting out Christianity at our jobs, acting out Christianity in our schools and in our environments, where you see the need, if you can help meet that need. That's what this life was about. I wasn't created here for me. I was created here for others. You were created here for others. Who is your neighbor and who are you being a neighbor to? Is what this is all boiling down today. Who are my people? Everyone's our people because we're one people. We're one people. We, the people of the United States. We, the people. We are our people. And I think we lose that sometimes. I had this, I'm just going to close with this, and just maybe, I just feel like I need to break through something here. I had this lady come up to me at the end of one of my services, and she said to me, well, tell me what I should do, because I go on Facebook, and I'm fighting the Muslim religion on Facebook, and I'm getting a lot of fighting and a lot of anger coming back to them because I'm fighting the Muslim religion. What should I do? Stop it. Stop it. She's like, yeah, but how? I said, listen. She goes, how am I going to get people to Jesus if I'm not fighting? Tell them about Jesus. Why do you got to put somebody down in order to prove your point? I don't have to prove you wrong to prove to you that Jesus loves me. I think we got this all wrong. It's not about winning an argument. It's about living the life that Christ provided for us, and that example being a beacon of light that draws people to God. I don't need to fight you. I need to love you. She didn't really like that answer. I probably won't see her again. But I don't think Jesus would have did that. I don't think Jesus would have did that. I don't think Jesus would have fought like that. I think he would have just touched him and said, be delivered. Be set free. I have come to this world not to condemn you, but to set you free and to give you life and peace and joy. And if you're here today and you've never had that opportunity to experience the love of God, the agape love, the unconditional love, you know what that means? There's nothing you can do bad enough for God to stop loving you. But on the flip side, there's nothing you can do good enough to make him love you more. He chooses to love you just the way you are. If you've never had an opportunity to ask Jesus Christ to be part of your life, we want to offer you that today. And we want to do it in a real easy way. Everybody in the room is going to pray a prayer together. And at the end of that prayer, I'm simply going to ask you to raise your hand so that we can put a book in your hand, and that's it. And that book just talks about Christianity. We wrote it here in our church. It talks about what we believe and what next steps to take in this Christian walk. If you're here today and you would like to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we want to stand with you. We cheer with you. We cry with you. We're happy for you. If you'd like to take one step further, there's a card on the back of the seat in front of you, and it just says, I accepted Jesus Christ today. And if you fill that out, we will follow up on you and just ask if you have any other questions about the decision that you made today. And the prayer goes like this, if you guys repeat it with me. Dear God, I come to you just like I am. I believe that Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. I believe that he died on the cross and he rose for me. Jesus, I accept you now into my life to change me and to make me new. I will serve you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that for the very first time, would you shoot your hand up real quick so you can put that book in your hand? Anybody else? I see all the way in the back, over here in the back, 3, 4. Anybody else? 5. Awesome. Anybody else? Real quick, 6, 7, 8. Praise God. Anybody else over here? 9. Awesome. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Woo! Hey, if you raise your hand and if you want this, I hate that people just run out of here because they want to beat the traffic at the corner. Be careful anyway. We're still working on getting that sorted out. I did talk with the town because 2 weeks ago we had a pretty severe car accident out there. So they did get some of the letters that you guys wrote. It's actually an Orange County intersection. It's not a Town of Walk Hill intersection. So all of the stuff that we're doing and we're talking about keeps getting forwarded to the Orange County clerk's office. And that's the office that we're going to kind of just have to hound and to get this light done over there. So coming up at Easter, we know that we're going to have a lot of traffic going to 3 services. So we'll be hiring law enforcement to handle that corner. But anyway, my whole point of telling you all that is this. Don't just rush out of here. Take a second and hug on somebody. If you rose your hand today and you accepted Jesus Christ, I'll be right here. You give me a hug, kiss real quick before you leave because we're family. Amen? Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for your anointing in our lives. I pray a blessing over everyone in this house today, that they're the head and not the tail, above and not beneath. I thank you, Lord, that you bless the works of their hands as they go into the workforce tomorrow. Give them the mind of Christ. Let them see things before they happen. Give them wisdom at their jobs and the things that they're doing. I think that we're protected and safe as we leave here today. In Jesus' name, amen. We love you.